Good evening, everyone. Good evening, Arthur.
Hi, Dave.
Hello, folks. Those of you who have watched Liquid Antiquarian before will have a vague idea of what's about to come up. But those of you who are new to this channel, let me give a very quick précis of what we're about. My dear friend, Mr. Arthur Motley, and myself, Dave Broom, are enthusiastic amateur antiquarians. We both work in the world of drink, of ardent spirits in particular, and we love kind of looking at the slightly dustier and lesser explored areas of this phenomenal subject. We delve and we dive into some of the lesser known stories. We try and investigate what are often given as truths and see what the actual truth is. We love objects, we love paper, we love the tangible. We just love drink, and we love its history. And Liquid Antiquarian is basically about showing and telling about these extraordinary, extraordinary stories that you might not have heard before. This is our second broadcast. The first one was a pretty deep dive into the birth of the modern Scotch whisky industry with a look at the 1823 Excise Act. But tonight, well, you know, initially, looking at the title, I was thinking it's going to be celebratory because it's all about champagne. But it's champagne between 1914 and 1918, Arthur. It sounds, to be honest, it sounds pretty grim.
Well, yes, there are going to be some images of destruction and some images of a place at its lowest point. But I do think you know the end of this story. Everyone sitting at home knows the position that champagne now holds in society, which in itself is utterly fascinating. At the top of this pyramid of drinks, it is luxury par excellence. It is prestige. It is power. It has been drunk by czars and pop stars and kings and queens. We smash it on newly painted hulls to wish them a good virgin voyage, maiden voyage, should I say. The winning Formula One driver gets to spray it in the face of those below them in the podium. It is a drink that we use to mark almost everything positive in your life. You woo with it. You celebrate engagement with it. You toast a bride and groom with it. You wet the baby's head with it. Another one, I don't know if this is global, but certainly in the UK, you buy it to drink with fish and chips on in the first night in a new home, even though you can't afford any furniture. and you snub your nose at that future crippled with a mortgage by drinking champagne.
It is one of the great food matches, actually, champagne and fish and chips.
Also, yes. Too. Yeah, yeah. It's a great food match.
My granny had her first taste of champagne on the day I was born, so my head was wet with champagne. And her only comment about champagne was, "Oh, it's really good for bringing the wind up."
Well, I think we're going to be drinking some champagne later on, so apologies if that wind gets caught on camera. But also, it's like meta celebratory. It's meta luxurious in that you can interrupt a mundane Wednesday evening by opening a bottle of champagne. That becomes an event in itself, and I cannot think of any drink that does that. Just that's my favorite way to drink champagne when no one's expecting it. Suddenly your guest finds out, he's just popped over for a cup of tea, that you've got a bottle of champagne in the fridge, and pop. Shall we interrupt the mundane?
Yes. Damn mundanity.
So I just felt we're good at both drinking champagne. We're both going to be drinking
Opened like a duchess's fart.
So it's got to be top five noises in the world, isn't it? The sigh of an opening bottle of champagne.
Yeah, never let it pop.
No.
Here we go.
Are the top five noises, Dave? Have you got any more that you want to share?
The noise of astonishment, which comes from the terraces when Partick Thistle scored a goal. That's pretty special.
Do you know that is one of my top five, definitely.
Okay, there we go.
Not Partick Thistle specifically, but the sound of a football stadium at night when you're walking closer to it across the city.
Oh, nice.
And then yeah. Babies laughing, yeah. All the horse noises, galloping, whinnying, the other ones.
A rushing Highland burn yeah. with some alder leaves in it. We're drinking Paul Roger. We'll have a wee chat about it maybe at some point. Paul Roger Vintage 2013. So thank you, Paul Roger. Arthur, you're in very good health, my dear friend.
Cheers. I was already in, I'm afraid. I beg your pardon. Yeah, but let's, we'll let that settle. We'll keep trying it. We'll keep trying as we go along, and we'll come back to that. But yes, thank you, Paul Roger, for providing that. It's extremely kind and apt for a number of the topics we're going to discuss, not just champagne itself. So, as I say, you know the end of this story. You know that champagne occupies that position now. Therefore, even though I'm going to show you some bleak images of destruction from my postcard collection and other images as well, just bear in mind that they not only survive, they thrive. And after the First World War and other obstacles or difficulties that come afterwards, they somehow turn into this incredible powerhouse industry with a unique position in society. So I think this is a story of resilience and hope. Shall I begin?
Good. Yes, please. I'm immediately interrupting you. You've been talking about this for so long, and I'm dying to see all these amazing postcards and this story, because it's something I have never ever thought about, how champagne survived the First World War. It's what a brilliant idea to have a look at. So yeah, I'm going to sit back with my glass of champagne and enjoy it.
It'll be different to Monday's episode, if anyone did see that, which was pretty intense. This is going to be a lot of imagery. It's almost entirely postcards. And sit back and look at these images. I'll leave them to dwell on the screen a bit, because some of them are beautiful, because it just happens to coincide with a glorious era of postcard production and photography. And there were some incredible things. There's that granny's gas coming. there are some incredible images to capture by these photographers and this amazing early postcard industry. So Monday was a bit more the two of us. This will be just me. Dave, chime in whenever you like. And I think Friday is going to be you, and I'm going to sit back and relax. So, I mean, firstly, we just need to talk about champagne in the start of the 20th century. It is a drink that it has already seen huge success. It does already represent this glamour, this power, this prestige, romance / sex, I would say. That postcard on the right, I'm not convinced those two are married. But the image on the left, I just think it's just beautiful illustration. That script is from the person who sent the postcard, which is common because for a period you could only write on the front rather than the place where we used to write it on postcards. So, and it has done this in the home market, but also through exports as well. It has been for some time a very successful industry, wine industry, on actually the very edges of where you can reasonably sustain a wine industry. I mean, you'll know all about this as well, Dave, but it is liminal. It is making wine on the borders of where it's so possible, where it's possible, because it's so far north. The ripe's barely graping. The grapes rarely ripen because of lack of sunlight and temperature. And so it is actually a difficult place to sustain a wine industry. And the way this is supported is by a central agent, which is the maison, the blenders. So you have a situation where you have many growers who own small parcels of land selling their fruit to centralized blenders, branders effectively, marketeers, but it's an early to use that term, and shippers and salespeople who are playing this incredible high stakes game of sales to the top levels of society around the world. And that might be the Russian royal family, that might be an emergent upper class in America, that might be the courts all around Europe. But there is tension there also. And this tension, actually, if I just talk about sales, actually, there's one amazing fact I wanted to mention. So firstly, England is hugely important, and London. Sales are enormous at the end of the 19th century into London for dry champagne, and the English play a key role in demanding this dry champagne, and even demanding the sparkling stuff many centuries before. But let's not go into that, because the English invented champagne. That's a big topic. Sure. Let's not do that one tonight. But anyway, it's hugely important in the development of the businesses of champagne. So one fact I pulled out that the guys over at Paul Roger passed over to me was in, Justerini and Brooks, so a shipper into London, ordered 30,000 bottles of the 1874 vintage. 300,000 bottles. Now, they were smaller in those days, but still, that's a hell of an order. My job is as a buyer for Rosemar Whiskey's whiskey retailer, and Drinkmonger, a mix, but lots of wine also. And I almost wonder if that person lost their job. That's a hell of an order. Like that screams at me, overstocking issues. But who knows? Hopefully not. But
salesman probably got a good bonus if it does not.
Yeah. I would think so. So London is pouring a lot of champagne, and in two actually very different contexts, you start seeing great and very famous hotels like the Savoy and the Ritz. Opening up, which is a public space to go out with your partner and treat and pour and order champagne in that conspicuous way, we now understand. But also the dinner party is also a theatre of performance where you treat your guests to the very, very best, and champagne could play a role there as well. So huge amounts are being shipped over there. But as I said, you have this unusual situation which still exists today, although the maison, the brands, as you know, the Moet, Paul, Verve, Krug, Bollinger, whoever, they now own a little bit more land and grow their own fruit a little bit more, but by no means not the majority still. Back then, it was unusual that the means of production, and it's still a bit unusual now, but the means of production is not owned by the people who are selling it and branding it. That provided or produced tensions. And still does today. But those tensions actually boiled over. So I'd love to do a whole episode about things like this, but revolution, booze revolution. So this is Révolution en Champagne, April 1911. And so they were trying to define what was and wasn't champagne, where grapes could be grown and put into wine that could be called champagne. And Laube was one area that was excluded, and suddenly it's gone from here, but there was another area that was excluded, and it was discussed, and it boiled over, it simmered over, basically. So, and that is destruction, actually, of champagne houses. The one on the right is Ducoin, and a Perrier champagne. So lots and lots of people actually marched north towards the centres of the commercial centres. These are actually photographs. One on the left really looks like a painting, doesn't it? It's been zoomed in a little bit, but they barricaded, and you can see people marching in that grand French tradition. but they were worried. There was anger. There was it was, as I say, a difficult place to make wine. The Maison had done pretty well, and we will come on to that later. But it wasn't outrageous wealth everywhere, and there was fruit being brought in from other places. And there was wine being made and called champagne. So I've left this for a little while to see if you can work it out. You got it, Dave? What do you think that is?
Well, I would say that is some sort of retaliatory action by Germans.
Yeah, so it's German champagne / yeah. sect, but they are yeah. putting the word champagne on it. So from Dresden. So there was discontent. It was popular, but there were threats, I suppose, if you can sum it up like that. I'd also just like to say that when the First World War comes here, this is not the first time they have had to deal with war. Champagne occupies this position, and we will cut when we actually come on to the First World War. I'll show a map that will show exactly where it is in relation to Paris. But you will look at just under 100 miles east of Paris, effectively, and it's on that east-west corridor to the east, basically. And so the Franco-Prussian War happens. There are a series of battles, so they are quite used to the idea of armies marching across their vineyards, armies looting their cellars, or either in victory or defeat, and having to host the French army. This is Napoleon in the cellars of Moët et Chandon. And I think Napoleon's lost the one on the right, hasn't he? He's drinking champagne out of a cannonball, looking a bit gloomy. So
still, he had some champagne.
You know? He did, yeah. And even if we think about the concept of sabrage, which is opening a bottle of champagne with a sword, it's a pretty warlike way to open a bottle of anything. So ils sont passés par là. They went that way. And that seemed to happen a lot. Battlefields littered with broken champagne bottles and armies marching through. But it is an agricultural place also. So I've mentioned these centres of commerce, but it is an agricultural place. It still is, but at the turn of the last century, absolutely. So don't know the date of this, but it looks pretty early. Mm-hmm. Close planting, closer than you would get nowadays. The towns do not look like that anymore. So that is I. Here we have... Yeah, and beautiful. So effectively planting and digging. Beautiful just images.
Fantastic images. Absolutely gorgeous, you know. That chap with the spade looks like something out of a Van Gogh painting, you know, his early stuff before he went to the south of France. Extraordinary.
Mm. So again, above I... I've done that already, a big problem. So here they are. So this is getting more into harvest time. So they're weeding off to the right there, the gents, and off to the left there, they're actually picking. So hand-picked, but of course they are still hand-picked. That is the only way you can pick a champagne grape, if you want to call it that.
Phylloxera. I mean, that strikes me as being quite late in Phylloxera, from my basic knowledge of wine.
You are sharp as a tack. So as you, in fact, the date there is, it helps you. I always think of phylloxera as being a great aid to the whiskey industry, actually, mm-hmm. by this little mite that would come along and eat, ravage a lot of the vines in France. But actually, Champagne was pretty slow. The Champagne region was pretty slow to sort out this problem. And so this, I mean, this photograph on the left, that they are sulfuring the vines for this purpose to try and get rid of phylloxera. Really kind of a full 20 years after I would have thought that would have been a problem, but it still was just another of the many challenges that Champagne had had to face, phylloxera. Yeah. That image on the right, it's strangely nostalgic to me, a 1980s kind of French library school learning card thing. I think we had them in England as well when I grew up, but it was just the style of it just reminded me of these things. But obviously a much older illustration before, and you can kind of feel the consternation of everybody there, people burning stuff, people hacking stuff up, people in stovepipe hats pointing at things.
Well, you've also got to remember what the devastation caused by phylloxera, because essentially all the vines died. Entire vineyard had to be replanted. I think the impression I'm getting is, you know, this extraordinary resilience or stupidity. But I think it's resilience in these people who have got armies trundling along, raiding their cellars, bombing their vineyards. Now you've got a louse destroying them, and they keep on going. And they keep replanting. I mean, it's something that you just don't think about. I think the human history of drink is the one area that we've been lax in talking about. This is great. Loving it. Sorry. Just thought I'd say that.
Don't be sorry. So, I mean, that's why when we first decided to do this format, you know, a long time ago when we were talking around, you know, could it be a book, could it be all this, I just thought, oh, I can do all my champagne. Yeah, because I'd been buying and buying and buying. I just couldn't turn down.
No, these are amazing.
Beautiful, beautiful photography of people doing the work. And sometimes that is a little left out of the champagne story in particular. Many other drinks also. But in Champagne particularly, you know, these teams of people, lunch in the vineyard, and actually local people as well who have been doing it for generations. And as I understand it, it could be a bit more itinerant work now, people moving through. And well, I don't know if these are local people. That's maybe me overreaching. It just felt like that to me. So then the town of Avizé in the background, those beautiful baskets of grapes, which now, I mean, champagne grapes are, I mean, the prices are just absurd. You hear prices of 15 euros, €8 a kilo or something like that. And it takes a kilo and a half to make a bottle. I mean, before you've done anything, grapes, woof.
Oh, that's a lot of grapes.
But I suppose I'm dwelling on this because we're going to see Aubervilliers. So Aubervilliers, yes, that is where Dom Perignon hung out, isn't it?
No.
So
yes, indeed. I was thinking before, and I kind of anticipating that we're about to dive into the meat of your tale here with. Stories of the war. Perhaps we should pick things up a little bit and then just have a wee chat about the wine itself.
Please.
Because, you know, it's very, very briefly, because this is one absolutely, absolutely wonderful. 2013 vintage. So this has spent 7 years. So it's very newly released. So it's been 7 years in the Paul Roger cellars. Very good vintage. And, you know, you only release vintage champagnes in exceptional years. Classic Paul Roger blend, predominantly Pinot Noir, so 60% Pinot. So you get that kind of richness, especially in the palate, I think. 40% Chardonnay. When you taste it, initially, it's still really quite assertive. Really, really great acidity, and that acidity is going to allow it to age magnificently. You need that real spine of acidity coming through. And Champagne Young, the wines that Champagne are made from are insanely acidic, but that is why it ages so well. But in the middle of the palate, you're beginning to see that richness and that red fruit coming through, a little bit of that kind of bready autolysis just beginning to build and build. And this will last and last and last. To be honest, we're probably drinking it
a bit young.
A little bit young. You know, I would quite happily stash this away for a few years, and it will just continue to mature and get richer and weightier and incredibly complex. Fantastic, fantastic wine.
Yeah, I think it's pretty newly released out of the cellars.
But it's great. Yeah, absolutely wonderful. What an absolute treat to try. Quite limey on the finish, actually.
Yeah, so much acidity. It's going to age really, really well. You have that feeling. And just briefly, you mentioned the mental acidity of champagne and the base wines. Mm. Actually, what we're going to see, actually, I'll come back to that. But I suppose we should mention a little bit of the champagne process, because it's maybe a factor of champagne marketing that they don't actually tell the consumer that much about how it's kind of made. They're like, oh, don't worry about it, just enjoy it, which actually I like about champagne. It doesn't lecture at you. It doesn't lecture at the consumer. You don't have to, you don't have to do a evening course to understand it. They just say, enjoy it. Everyone can enjoy it. It's weirdly democratic like that. No one has to be a wine bull to enjoy champagne. Even though we can bore people about drinks, but anyway.
which we're about to do.
I'm sure.
We're entertaining.
So grapes, press house. So once they've handpicked those grapes, they would transport them to a press house, and no stomping on grapes here. It's done very carefully and so quickly but gently. You want to preserve this freshness, this cleanness. You don't want any compounds kind of building up. So it's got this kind of clean character that will develop into or provide that kind of base for really interesting action in the with the secondary fermentation, because it's very what we would call a process driven wine, isn't it? That's quite a nice cooperage, isn't it, Dave?
Beautiful. That is wonderful. And I'm a sucker for a good cooperage. That's a great one.
Yeah. They stack up the back, and then presumably the little manager's office halfway down on the left. Guys bringing bottles for rinsing. And beyond this wine, on the surface, we also have in Champagne a subterranean world, the cave, the cellars. So these are the guys digging out a cellar, a cave, basically, by pickaxe, out of this chalk. So you very often see people talk about champagne in terms of the terroir, in terms of the chalky soil. But the fact that these major towns, Epernay, Reims, they are built on this chalk, it gives them this incredible maturation, cathedral beneath them, this kind of soft chalk that they can dig into and make these incredible cellars that stretch for miles. And is a huge part of the ability to make champagne. And I would argue it's this piece of equipment that no one else could possibly have, in the same way that a Dunwich warehouse. We talked about that maybe the other day, weren't we? Mm-hmm. So beautiful, beautiful, miles and miles of cellars. And when the world calms down a little and we can all travel, I urge you to visit them if you haven't. It's just incredible, that the sight of all these bottles of champagne. So this is a point where effectively they've put a little bit more yeast in there after having blended a wine together with these fiercely acidic wines. I mean, I think if you work in the booze trade, it's a real moment, isn't it? When these revelatory things, the first time you sit down with a chef de cave or and do the job that they do. Yeah. And like you and I have sat with blenders and you're like, I can see what they're doing. I can have a go. And what do you know? They're better at it than me. But with champagne, you're like, I have absolutely no idea what's going on.
No. They're all just mad acidity. And the skill is, absolutely off the scale. To be able to tell those minuscule differences in acidity, in aroma, in mouthfeel at that very, very early stage is quite an extraordinary ability. So
when effectively you're sitting down and drinking 30 glasses of battery acid. It's unbelievable. But these very acidic wines will be transformed into something beautiful by this magical secondary fermentation process, where a little bit more yeast is put into the bottle. It's returned to the cellars, as I showed here. And then we have also the Caillère as well, which is, so those incredible man-made elements aren't enough. You also have the Caillère. So they discovered Roman chalk pits that the Romans had dug out when they occupied the area much, much longer ago. I think a cow fell in, possibly a sheep. Anyway, in fact, probably a sheep, because they do. It was an important wool trading centre. So let's go with that, because...
A large sheep.
Exactly. Fell in. And so the enterprising Champenois turned them into, clean them out, dug them out, and connected them also, and turned them into this beautiful cathedral of champagne maturation. So that religious statue has been put in there, and you can see the stacks of the champagne bottles, which will be turned periodically to stimulate the yeast and stop it from cracking up. But ultimately what you get is product. And champagne is a fiercely economic and a fiercely commercial product. It plays this high stakes game internationally, which we're going to come on to. Feels a bit, for much of its history, it's been a bit kind of boom and bust, people taking outrageous risks in dangerous markets. Veuve Clicquot made her name by smuggling bottles into Russia via Holland and I think one other country, and then into Russia to break an embargo to get the Russian royals to the czars to taste their whiskey first, champagne first. Sure. Sorry. What a stunning image of bottles lined up for shipping.
Yeah.
We're not playing around. And they also did it through technology as well. There is assembly line attitude there clearly, and pushing innovation and pushing science and pushing technology. I don't know for sure, but I imagine Reims and Epinay, or certainly Reims, would have been one of the first places outside Paris to get electricity. They were I think they were building their own electricity stations themselves. And then this international branding and marketing and selling, this is a universal international expo in Paris. That's a pretty old postcard, that one, 1903. This is not mine. I took this from a maisonchampagne.com website. But this is them dragging this huge tunnel all the way to Paris. So the 100 miles or so, look how many oxen they've got. I think they're probably exaggerating a little. But anyway, but I have seen this, and it is absolutely huge. I forget the name of the artist, Emile. I can't remember his name, but the artist who designed these beautiful carvings up here. And so, the incredible stunts as well in Champagne. So that's Mercier doing that. Again, there's a railway here, I think, in the front of these buildings. That's from 1903. This is Pommery, which is insane. Like, it's turrets everywhere, palaces and castles. And it's that boulevard you see kind of halfway up the shop, going diagonally up to the top right. You can get two double-decker buses down there. This place is vast. And this money is made relatively quickly. Sure, champagne houses exist. but suddenly they're making huge amounts of money very, very quickly. Could lose it all again. Things could go well.
But then
war. Poilu. Yeah. So I wanted to, in fact, I wanted to show those two sides because you can see the complications. You can see the difficulty. You have agriculture. If war touches it, then agriculture becomes difficult. You have big international business. If war comes, that becomes exceptionally, and war doesn't just touch it. So I thought the simplest way to show this was by, I found in St. Andrews, this old book in a charity shop. Mm. It's almost cool. It's got that little dog-eared bit. So The Marm Campaign by Major F.E. Witten. The Campaigns and Their Lessons. So it's published in 1917. So the war is still going on.
Right.
And Major Witten is just starting to think there might be a few lessons.
Might have done this a little bit wrong, chaps.
Yeah. But the tone is not particularly conciliatory yet. Hmm. But thankfully, I've never read a military analysis book written by a major, and they're not that much fun, to be perfectly honest, but they did have these beautiful maps. So I thought it was the best way to put Champagne in its position relative to the war. So it's a short video. Hopefully it will make sense. Here we go.
So I'm using this old war map to give you an idea of the geography and to show you quite clearly how the First World War, right from the beginning, is right on top of Champagne as a region and as an industry. So, firstly, the basic elements of geography here, where things are. So, this is Paris here, this is Reims, and this is Epernay, Chalon, Avizé, you might hear from later on, or see on postcards rather. So Reims to Paris is just under 100 miles. And here you have the battlefront for the First Battle of the Marne that took place between the 6th and the 12th of September. 2 million men fought in this battle. So it was huge with numerous casualties. Over 420,000 French casualties estimated in the first 2 months, 500,000 Germans in the first year. And behind these fronts, you have to imagine the transport of all these men and equipment and animals to supply this battle, but also, sadly, all those casualties to be brought back out as well, and huge amounts of destruction. So the blue line here is the German forces, the red line is the French army commanded in the western flank by Joffre, who may come up later on. This little section here is the British expeditionary forces. This second element is a postcard with a map from the perspective of wine and vineyards. So it's on a different scale. So this is Reims here. This is Epernay down here. So the shaded areas on this postcard are the principal vineyards. So this is a Montagne de Reims, where the best Pinot Noir is grown. This is a Côte de Blanc, right down here, where the best Chardonnay is grown. Beyond this postcard, there would be the Côte de Cézanne, and even beyond this map, there would be the Aube, which is much further south. And then through here, you have the Vallée de la Marne. So the Marne is the river, and that is what the battle is named after. So you can really see how this very first battle cuts a swathe right through the Champagne industry, but also the agriculture of Champagne also. This battle is considered a victory for the French, a defeat for the Germans, who are in retreat afterwards after occupation of Epernay and Az. But the problems for these towns do not end there, in particular France, and we will see a huge amount of evidence of that later on.
Okay, Dave. So there you go.
Perfect.
A military map showing just how affected it was. And that's a zoomed in version of that map I would show. So I've circled Reims to the north and Epernay to the south. And I've marked a few Grand Cru vineyards as well there, Sillery, Ambonnet, Bouzy. I can't see there. Is it the other one for that? Chouilly, probably, Côte de Blanc. So there we have it. I mean, in map form, it doesn't just touch it. And it's a little bit of a mystery to me that how not everybody knows that Champagne it was in the middle of the principal battles of the First World War. But then I didn't know until I started looking into it. So let's deal with people now. So these are some postcards of the Poilu. So the Poilu is an affectionate nickname for the French soldiers. And these, obviously, rather romanticized. A little bit more romance going on with these
there
ones.
There we are. No, those French soldiers.
Yeah. Repos bien gagné. So, a rest well earned, I think that would translate as. She's distracted. Anyway,
she is. It's a lovely arrangement of flowers.
It is, yeah. That's maybe.
Although her husband might be looking in through the window.
It might be that. Oh, yeah. Anyway, and the one off to the right, sent to Red Ruth, Cornwall, to a miss, just addressed as Miss. Oh. That intrigued me. So, I didn't just want to show the French. This is a formalized arrangement of German soldiers in a barracks, presumably in Germany. I like to think, but it's hard to prove. And I'm going to be doing a bit of work with a really nice guy called Stefan Kahr, who's a great whiskey fan, who's going to help me with some translation and a bit of research on these kind of elements. But I found that there is this fashion, or that there was a popularity of doing these stylized pictures within army barracks. And I just found them moving. You see some toys there, some kind of, are they mascots? These are probably officers, I think. And they're always drinking in these pictures. So, okay, this is ahistorical. I want to do more research, but it feels like a last drink before they go to battle.
Yeah, yeah.
But I want to do more research. So this is presumably soldiers also within barracks.
Don't also look like the officers. Yeah.
No. Also with the drinks, there's a chap with some kind of mandolin at the back, a football, I think. So, and then from the front, you also find a huge amount of postcards from the front. Also, actually, not a huge. Some, they're harder to find. And so these are Germans again, and they seem to be recreating this idea, but out in the field. It's hard to see at this resolution, but the chap at the back with the fag in his mouth and the beard, he's pretending to play a violin, but the violin is a brick. The guy lying down on the right, he has some kind of sausage, and the guy on the left seems to be having some kind of ham, but I'm not sure it is a ham. I think they're pretending it's a ham. And then this is the reverse of that postcard. And the ones in the field you find written in this curious kind of pencil, which presumably is what they could have.
Yeah.
So this one is from Heinrich to Anna back in Hamburg. So I wanted to put those in because I do feel that people, especially in the UK, conflate the Second World War with the First World War. The First World War is not the Second World War.
No.
They suffered greatly also.
Yeah.
German prisoners in Bazancourt. This was actually, so it's a postcard of a German prisoner German prisoners, and it's sent in 1915 back to Dresden by an Alfred, by a German. Who knows who was taken prisoner? And these are prisoners being marched through Reims.
These are extraordinary. Sorry to interrupt you there, Arthur, but just very quickly, because you know we think of postcards as being, you know, having a jolly time in holiday and, you know, saucy postcards and nice views and all of that. Whereas postcards in those days are social history. You know, they're high quality photography, but it's also social history. You know, it's this idea that the notion of the postcard has changed significantly since those early days.
Unbelievably so. That's really perceptive. And I want to know more about where they were sold and by whom. Mm. They were in little tabacs, or were they distributed to barracks, or I don't know. But what I think of as postcards is, you know, those racks. And if you went, you know, outside a little newsagent or wherever in Marbella or wherever, if you went there every year for the same 10 years, same 10 years, you'd get the same postcards being sold, just repeated. But these postcards are sent quickly, immediately after the event. And I haven't got time to go through this because we're already getting on the way. But, like, this is one side of the story.
Mm.
I'm only showing you half the story. And it's going to take me a long time, but I'm already talking to a few people who are helping me with translation. And part of the issue is actually translation of the words. I'm pretty good at French, but the handwriting is just indecipherable. Indecipherable. And Stefan's already asking his granny, because they have a word for this different type of script in German. So it's very, very hard to translate these things. But there's also a feeling, and I might as well say it now, there's almost this feeling that they wanted to remember.
Yeah.
And you'll see that later on.
Yes.
And so there's a documentarian feel about it, but on a mass scale. So there's people obviously doing a little business, or I don't know how big the business was, a business, but then there's people documenting themselves by the purchase of this postcard and sending it. Although very often there's a real disconnect, I would just say, it's between what's on the front of the postcard and what's on the back.
What's on the back, it's like, sorry, we are, and I know we're pressed for time, but, you know, it's early 20th century Instagram. In a really weird way, this is what I'm doing with my mates. And on the back, if you can read an Instagram, you have to maybe read the subtext, but, you know, there it is. You know, this is what we're doing. Boom. Well, right. Next postcard.
Yeah, although sometimes I'll show these images of unbelievable destruction. On the back, it will say, went to the market and bought some cheese. See you next month. It's really strange. It's really, really strange. Anyway, move on.
Sorry, onwards.
No, we people. So these are what they call spahi, Moroccan. So spahi were basically from the French African colonies. So Morocco, Algeria, I'm missing one. But anyway, these are Moroccans. So we are starting to talk a little bit more about those who fought within the British Empire who were not white. And this was the case in France as well. And there they are, camped out in a French farm. Mm. The Russians. So I wanted to put different nationalities, because if you were a farmer in France, yes, you were used to armies coming through, but there were different people, different faces, huge armies, different technologies. And this is interesting. So we've got artillery and we've got cavalry, and that kind of foreshadows how different the war was from the beginning to the end. I mean, we're not historians. I'm certainly not a military historian. So I don't want to overreach here. I've got these images. I want to show them to you. It is we, the Russians. So,
wow,
that contrast from cavalry to something new, something alien. I think that's such a human theme of what the First World War was. It was a war that was completely different from the beginning to the end. I think I'm comfortable saying that at least. Here, looting, I mentioned this is Germans looting champagne, but also beer, sitting on top of a piano. This is probably the occupational house, I penne. So I don't know if I've shown these to you yet, Dave.
No, I've not seen them. It's banknotes.
It's emergency currency.
Yeah, that's so amazing.
Yeah.
Local currency.
Yes. So what happened was the Germans occupied Epernay. Maurice de Paul Roger was mayor of Champagne. So this brings us back a little bit more to Champagne, the industry, Champagne, the people. So Maurice Paul Roger. So he was the head of the Paul Roger Champagne House, which we are drinking, but he was also mayor. Apparently the chief of police, who really it would have been his role to keep order between the occupying forces and the invading army. Someone needs to. We think of collaboration. You know, we use that dismissive, disparaging word, collaboration. But life does need to continue. There does need to be order. People still need to make champagne. That's what people do here. Mm. And so the chief of police absconded, or I don't know if that's quite the word, fled anyway, with the town's financial resources, effectively, for safekeeping.
Well, yeah. So he said.
This is ahistorical. Again, Paul Roger weren't good enough to suggest this, but what they did say is that Maurice Paul Roger did step up. So he took that role and printed and backed an emergency currency. So you see that recet municipal Epernay, and then the signature of the mayor, which is Maurice Paul Roger, 5th of September 1914.
Mm.
So actually the day before the Battle of the Marne, I've only spotted that actually since tonight, but the Battle of the Marne is 6th of September to 12th of September, I believe. And this was necessary for paying workers to go out into the fields and make champagne, because despite those 2 million men fighting, they still made a wine in those vineyards. And you saw where that line went. So this is Epernay before the war, a postcard from 1910, or at least postmarked 1910. Dating postcards can be tricky, but this one is at least postmarked 1910, so we know the buildings are as they stand. But now we're starting to look at cities and how they were affected, or towns, I should say, particularly Reims and Epernay. This is Epernay, so again, linking to a very famous champagne house, Moët et Chandon. So bombed, destroyed, and many, many offices and buildings of the champagne industry were destroyed. But really, Reims, and that is the Cathedral of Reims after the war, after it was bombed. Now, this is was an emotive issue for the French. So this is it being shelled on the 19th of September. This is the cathedral after the fire.
Mm. Wow. Good grief. That's an extraordinary image.
So this is entitled The Choir Who Stayed in the Stalls. So this is a very emotive issue for the French at the time. And they describe it, and you'll see some postcards that are actually titled Le Crime de Reims, the crime. Reims, after the first Battle of the Marne and the German forces retreated, they retreated effectively into the hills and just began shelling Reims. And it had over 1,000 consecutive days of bombing, with some particularly heavy days. So a figure I saw was of the 40,000 buildings in the house, 40 were habitable and left standing after the war. So these are ordinary houses. The one might be a factory on the left, but, you know, ordinary buildings. And anyone who has studied the First and Second World War in school knows about the Treaty of Versailles that came afterwards, which we may come on to later on, and war preparations and the knock-on effect after the Second World War. But the destruction of house, and I think the behaviour of the French in the Second World War, and again, there's a lot of very disparaging things said about the French in the Second World War. Reims was extremely important to them. The kings had been coronated there since the 11th or 12th century. Napoleon wasn't, but they had been. It was a sacred place. It was a very, very special place to them, and it was destroyed. But I mentioned the subterranean world. So they they retreated underground. They had these cellars underground, and that became the upside down, the world underneath the horrors that were going above. And businesses continued under there. Nicolas Runard? I'm not sure. One of the Runard family, he kept his Runard champagne business running with doing the accountancy, strapped to a pontoon that was floating around like a boat in these cellars as the war raged above because it filled with water. There's a school, Ecole Joffre. I mentioned Joffre. They were named after the heroes who were fighting above. Yes. They played sport under there. They had markets under there. Everything happened underground because they had these miles and miles of cellars. Mm. Churches were destroyed. That's not Reims elsewhere. And if you move out into the countryside also, more. And I have too many of these destroyed photographs, photographs of destroyed buildings. There's another Moroccan soldier, and I just... from an aesthetic perspective, I just thought that was interesting. Well, what did that say to you, Dave? I mean,
I think when we think about the First World War, you know, we think about the terrible sacrifices, and we think about the trenches and the suffering that went on in the trenches. And, you know, my grandfather was one of the soldiers in the trenches, but we forget about the towns which were destroyed. It's bizarrely, perhaps, it's something that we don't see. We're used to seeing these images from the Second World War, but we're not used to seeing this from the First World War because everything's on the front line. And seeing the civilian cost of that First World War is a really sobering thing. This is extraordinary. What struck me there was, ironically, the population of Reims, for example, were saved by their industry, because if they hadn't been making champagne, they wouldn't have been digging out those cellars. And if they hadn't been digging out those cellars, they would have had nowhere to go.
Very good point. I hadn't thought of that. That there is a train station at Sillery. Sillery is historically extremely important in Champagne as well, and they were known as, before Champagne as a category or region was had this international category branding, almost, if you want to call it that. The wines of Sillery were very well known. I think Jefferson liked the wines of Sillery, but also, you know, the all the infrastructure, the transport. You think of all the huge effects on these wine growers, or the farmers, but also anybody else worked in the industry, with millions of men and machinery coming in and then going back out. How did that happen? Just this huge, you know, even from a migrationary element, you know, getting all those people to the front door. airline is absurd. I just thought the photographer seemed to be looking at this in terms of, it looks like Morocco. It looks like an impoverished third world country.
Yeah.
And he's placed someone from, you know, Morocco, which they would have seen as, you know, their subjects effectively, or, you know, anyway, I thought that one was interesting.
Yeah, it's funny you should say that, and, you know, sort of to dive in here. But it reminds me, the story reminds me, I went to Lebanon not long after the major war afterwards, once that had finished, to go and see winemaking over there. And spent a lot of time with winemakers, you know, especially Serge Hoshiar from Chateau Moussard, whose winery was in Beirut, or is in Beirut, but the vineyards in the Bekaa. And Beirut was Beirut was devastated, but they only missed one vintage, trucking those grapes over from the Bekaa into Beirut. And I kind of went, I was saying, well, why did you do it? Why didn't you just leave? He went, because we had to do it. It is what we do. And even he took me around, and they were beginning to rebuild Beirut. And he took me around this new development that he'd started. He was starting up a gym and everything. And he said, I started building this during the war. And I go, why? He said, because I had to believe the war was going to end. And there is something about the resilience of the human spirit, I think, that comes out of so much of this, that even though Champagne is devastated, we're drinking Paul Rushy.
Exactly. And I have, that's lovely thoughts. Thank you, Dave. So we've shown buildings, we've shown destruction of buildings, and I wanted to bring it back, and I suppose we're coming to the end, to the land and the fact that it does tie nicely what you're saying, because it's bloody difficult making champagne. You go there and they're always talking about the next thing that could go wrong. to get a vintage such as we're drinking now is rare. They have managed to improve techniques. You know, it's got a little easier through man's skill. But it's difficult, and it particularly would have been difficult there. And they did go into this, First World War with some bad harvests as well under their belt. And I think it's something about that difficulty that's kind of, and the fact that they had such problems before if you were born in 1890, you know, your grandfather might have fought in the Franco-Prussian War. I may need to move that bit. You know, you're going to fight in the First World War. You're probably going to fight in the Second World War as well. You know, your children probably will as well. And, you know, we've drunk half a bottle of champagne now. I'm getting my dates wrong, but they are used to this. They are hardwired to have this resilience into them, it seems. And plus, I suppose, the other thing that they had in their favour is they have a wine that ages. So as long as it's still sitting there in the cellar, once you get up and going again, you've got something to sell. And I think that probably happened at the end of the First World War, that you've got something to sell immediately. So you've got capital. So your industry isn't destroyed. And certainly the Second World War, that was a big focus of them, is keep things in the cellar. Don't let them plunder everything. But again, a huge subject. But I wanted to bring it back to the land, to the fact that these people are farmers, they are growers. And even if you speak to Hubert de Billy, who is the head next generation of Paul Roger, he talks like a farmer. He's worried about the vines flowering. He's worried about, he knows exactly what's happening in the weather. They are farmers. And so just this brutal, bleak.
Oh, my God.
The land, you know, that they are obsessed with, that they move with, especially if you look back to some of these images here.
Mm.
These are farmers. And this is what they are left with.
Yeah.
Moonscapes. And mess. Metal. Chemicals, you know. Must have been horrendous. And how this clear-up process happened, I don't really know, to be perfectly honest. I tried to look into it. I couldn't find much conversation of it. There were a few interesting things about... they started paying the British, and I think the British instigated it, but they shipped tens of thousands of Chinese over.
Right.
And yeah, via Canada, actually, to help with this cleanup effort. I'm sure there were some prisoners of war that also had to help as well. And these Chinese were paid, they were paid, I think, a third of their wages into their pockets, and then two thirds went back to their family, which was, I forget where, it was one of the poorer areas of China. But, you know, barbed wire was invented in the First World War and littered the whole area. You know, there was gas,
unexploded ordnance. Yeah.
Millions and millions of tons of exploded ordnance and unexploded ordnance. So, yeah, it's just quite incredible. And I suppose I like this shot also. So this is taken on the August after the end of the First World War. And yeah, it appears to be some small ceremony after a long discourse, is that talk, and a distribution of flowers by the children. The procession left to the cemetery on the road to Shalom. So I did promise that it wouldn't be too bleak, but I think it does show that, like, how, you know, how can you deal with such horror and such destruction? But we know that they did. And the incredible thing is, this was just the start. You know, the first World War, they then had to deal with the collapse of the Russian royal family, which was a huge customer. Crystal was invented for them, but yeah, absolutely huge. The Great Depression, Prohibition, the Great Depression, and then the Second World War. And that is such a big story.
Part two.
Yeah, I mean, we may need some, that's harder in terms of objects and artifacts. We've been blessed by the quantity and the quality of these postcards that are relatively affordable. It has stacked up, I must say, but and I've only shown you a small quantity of them,
as your dear wife would tell me. Yeah,
no doubt. But I find it a reason for optimism that an industry, a people, a place can rise out of that and become this glorious and magnificent trick. We didn't mention Churchill enough, probably, did we?
No, we probably didn't. Well, you know, he was, you know, Minister for War, helped immensely by Stevenson of Johnny Walker fame. But yeah, Paul Rogier was his favourite champagne. And he used to drink it, certainly in the Second World War, he drank it, pint bottles of Paul Rogier, out of a silver tankard, which only people of a certain degree of class would still have in their household. Arthur.
Mine's pewter, but anyway. Yeah.
This has been absolutely extraordinary. Thank you. Thank you so much for this. I mean, it's just an amazing, amazing resource. I'm just looking at a couple of comments here. Joe McKercher there, who apparently is drinking Fifth Clicquot Rosé. There we go. Thank you, Joe. Glad you're enjoying it. And thank you, Peter. Thanks for all your comments as well. And one from our good friend Brian Robson there. Fascinatingly interesting. There we go. He's going to miss the talk on Friday. Curse you, but catch up. Yeah, it's fine.
Yeah. All these things are available to watch afterwards. I'm just looking at my sheet because I didn't look at it the whole time. And I'm just seeing if there's anything I missed out that would bug me. I think the Churchill thing, the Churchill-Paul Roger link. Has this very great relationship with Odette de Paul Roger in the Second World War as well. They have this beautiful correspondence that goes back and forth. Churchill says, "Gentlemen, we are not just fighting for France, we are fighting for Champagne." And there's these amazing elements of insurrection, of disobedience for Odette de Paul Roger. There's all sorts of resistance activities. But again, that's coming for the second one. But also German links actually to champagne houses as well. I should have said that from the beginning. Krug, Bollinger, Veuve Clicquot. I'm probably missing one. Mumm as well. These were German families also. Mumm apparently the family had registered as French. And I think they were even kicked out of the country and had their business requisitioned because they hadn't bothered to register as French. They were German. Verve, that was Joe kindly mentioning that, spurred my thought on that. And then the final one that was just a minor correction to... have you heard this thing about the Treaty of Versailles?
Tell me.
It is said, you will see it, that it is written into the Treaty of Versailles that champagne is protected, and that's when it becomes protected. I mentioned that from the FROMM sect at the beginning. That was supposed to prompt me on that thought. But it's not actually. I just brought out the element there. There is something, but it's not talking specifically about champagne, but they're starting to talk about appellation in respect of wine or spirits produced in the state. And I think that develops into something. And actually, the Second World War also hardens this need and desire to work collectively in order to survive. There's this consolidation process, but also working collectively to survive and market oneself as champagne, which must be a big reason for that success.
Yeah.
But I think that's all I've got, Dave.
That's amazing, Arthur. Extraordinary. Absolutely loved it. Absolutely loved it. Chapeau, my friend. Chapeau.
Oh. Thank you. By any measure, that's a beautiful photograph.
It's an extraordinary photo.
Anyway, that was something I wanted to put up. I really am done. Okay, great. So Friday, I get to sit back and you get to talk, and you're going to talk about rum.
Yeah, I'm going to talk about rum through the lens of a specific family, Scottish family called the Wedderburns. Who were incredibly influential in terms of rum importation, of Jamaican rum, especially in the 18th and 19th century. Gave their name to a style of rum, but a bit of mystery over that, which I think we may have solved. It's a story of rum. It's a story about how Scotland has turned its back or refused to accept it was involved in the slave trade. And we're going to be drinking some fine, funky Jamaican rum alongside it as well. So Yeah, family history, but big history of Rome as well.
Great. Well, I'll see you Friday. I'm looking forward to it, Dave.
It's going to be good fun.
Yeah, cheers. Good night, mate.
See you. Sleep well.